Welcome to the Startup Grind.
We are honored to be here and be with you and for us to just get together and listen to the speaker for today. Today we're privileged to have the CEO for Vodafone. I think he's actually the CEO for Vodafone Zambia and Vodafone-Afrimax group. His name is Lars Stork. He has an amazing startup track record, which we're looking forward to learning from him. Lars has worked for many organizations, including Airtel, Unilever, and he was named one of the top 100 most influential people in the telecoms industry by Global Telecoms Business. He has won a global award for the best innovation approach in terms of penetrating in rural areas in Africa. He's from Denmark, and he has lived and worked in 15 countries around the world. He has such a vast wealth of knowledge, and I'm really looking forward to just getting his story. Please put your hands together. In our tradition in Startup, and we really just want—we always want to appreciate people. It's not—you know—I mean, you know, someone that you know you look up to. You know, how are you going to clap your hands when you see them coming? The Ronies of this world, and who was walking up here? How would you feel? So please, let's just welcome and appreciate Mr. Lars. Okay, so welcome to Startup Grind. In our tradition at Startup Grind, we always want to get to know people. Mm-hmm. So if you could just tell us a bit about who you are.
Sure. Well, first of all, I'm delighted to be here this evening, and I'm delighted to be in such an informal environment, because that's really what I like, and that's what I appreciate. Well, my background, I was born in Denmark many, many years ago. To be more precise, in 1952. And my parents, my dad was a shoemaker, and my mom actually worked at the local telecommunications company. But that was the antiquated thing where they plugged these joysticks into different holes, so it was a long, long time ago. Now, I went to school in Denmark, and I went to university in Denmark. I graduated in economy. My first job was as a chief accountant. In those days, it was like being a bean counter. But nevertheless, in my very early days, I had many aspirations of what I wanted to become. So from a career perspective, where did I see myself end up? And at that time, I was only 19 years old. And my dream was to become a chief accountant of a medium-sized Danish company. That very quickly changed when I got into my professional career, and I now lived in 15 different countries around the world, from Norway in the north to Nigeria, if you will, in the south. I lived in New York for a few years. I lived in China for almost 2 years, and I have been in a very few businesses. I was 25 years with Unilever, that I think most of you know, which is a fast-moving consumer goods business. And Unilever took me around to many different places around the world. I think I visited in total around 253 different countries in my career. I left Unilever when I turned 50. And the reason I did that, I was tired of the corporate rat race and boardroom meetings and so on and so forth. And I started off as a consultant, like you do when you've got your career behind you and you sit down. And the only problem was my major clients was Unilever and a few others, so I very quickly decided this is not really for me. And then I was contacted by Mo Ibrahim. Some of you might know Mo Ibrahim. He's a guy that made his career in British telecoms, but he was from Sudan, a philanthropist, and he started Celtel. And how many of you actually know were here when Celtel was around? See, to me that was the good old days. I was, at that point, I was made chief operating officer of Celtel and was responsible for some countries in Africa, including Zambia. And David Wen, who worked for me, was the general manager or the managing director of sales at Zambia. And I came in when Zambia was around 250,000 subscribers. So been growing very slowly, but David and myself got our act together and we very quickly grew that network to around a million subscribers. And then it just continued and became a very successful business. Then it was taken over by Airtel, unfortunately. Same first and then Airtel. And it sort of got a little bit down from there. I think my initial exposure to Africa, and actually the reason I took the job, was my lack of knowledge of the African continent. Because I lived in New York and all these lovely places, but I never lived or never worked with an African organization. So that was really what appealed to me. It wasn't so much the telecom. I wasn't into cables and wires and the rest of it, because I'm a fast-moving consumer goods man as a baseline. But when I joined, I went to Zambia, I went to Malawi and Gabon, Sierra Leone, and latest in Nigeria. And Nigeria on the west coast is very different to Zambia. It's a much more fast-moving environment and a much more aggressive environment than it is here in Zambia. But the commercial experience you get from being in a country like Nigeria, in particular in Lagos, which is buzzing with commercial activity. And again, in the telecoms industry, you build a tower, you put some radios on it. When you build it in Lagos, you know, day two, it was congested because the demand for telecommunication services was so significant. So when I joined, the network is around 2.5 million subscribers. And when I left 3 years later, it was 20 million subscribers. So it's really fast-paced growth, but a very good school to go in. And again, I was managing the business at that time, and we did have a great time. My wife joined me, and she had a lovely expat life, and so on and so forth. Now, I retired from, this is the second time I retired, and we have a house in Tuscany in Italy, we bought the house while we were in Nigeria. And that was really to retire, relax, enjoy good Italian wine, good Italian food, and so on and so forth. I'm a very structured man. So when we decided where we would live, it was actually like a multiple choice. You know, Norway, no, Sweden, no, US, no. But Italy appealed to me because of the climate, the people, the wine, and the food. But I'm a man that very quickly lose my, I very quickly get bored. So what I started to do was to visit the surrounding vineyards in Tuscany. And I got into the wine business. And I was very taken back by the passion and the love of the land by I would call them farmers in the vineyards in the surrounding area where we lived. So I decided to write a book. I never written a wine book before, but I decided to write a book about wine and the life in these vineyards. And it was around 40 of them. Relatively small, but very passionate people, very lovable people. And the wine book was published in 2010. And it actually won two awards. It became the best wine book in Italy in 2010. To great envy from the Italians, to say, why the heck does it take a Dane to come to Italy to write a wine book about? And we had to go to, or not had to, but we went to Paris in the Gourmet Award ceremony, and it came second globally in 2010 as well, which was very good. And then we bought a bar, we selling wine and so on and so forth. But I got bored again. So then a friend of mine asked me if I want to go and set up a business for him in India. So I went to India for a couple of years. And that was to build a telecoms business, actually a 4G next generation LTE TDD business. And it went quite well, and we did some of the similar things that we actually now doing in Zambia. My wife joined me, but my wife hates Indian food, so it wasn't very successful, so I only stayed there for a couple of years. So I went back to Italy and managed the wine business and retired for the third time. Then Mo Ibrahim then suddenly called me again, and this was in 2012. He had acquired a healthcare business in Nigeria, consisting of a couple of hospital clinics and health clinics also in the rural areas. And he asked me if I was going to go and manage that and raise capital to further expand the healthcare business across Nigeria. So I went back to Nigeria, quite reluctantly actually. Even though I loved the commercial experience, you sort of lose your independence in Nigeria because you can't move around freely. I always had a bodyguard and the police and the rest of it. Anyway, I did that, and I did that for a year and a half, and then I came back and retired for the fourth time. I was called again, and this is only a year and a half ago, roughly. People I really didn't know, but they said this was Afrimax, and Afrimax Vodafone is the group I currently work for. But they asked me if I wanted to come and help build their businesses in Africa, and I could pick which country I wanted to go to. And I decided on Zambia. And I decided on Zambia for one reason. Because when we were here 10 years ago, and my wife was joining me on the trips, we love Zambia. It's got so much to offer. You can go to the falls, you can go on safaris and all of that. But it's a lovely country, got lovely people. And it got a huge potential because of the significant youth segment. Yeah? As you know probably better than I do, the youth in Zambia represents 70-75% of the total population. Now, two things can happen. We either provide an environment, and that's through the private enterprise, then followed by government. If you provide an environment where the young people are allowed to prosper, be educated, provided the internet connection, and provided tools to better themselves, that could be what will rescue Africa and enable prosperity and economical growth, not only in this generation, but the generations to come. If you don't do that, then that 600 million could be a time bomb. If you can imagine 600 million people where only 5% will actually be offered employment, that is a major, major problem. So therefore, I'm advocating that we need to provide the opportunities, the empowerment to the youth to better themselves and take Africa forward. And that's exactly what we've done in Zambia. Sorry, that was a bit of a long introduction.
No, it's actually interesting to hear.
No.
For retirements. Now, you know, we're at a time in Zambia where most of the youth, maybe even some people older than the youth, have started up companies. There's a lot of startups.
Yeah.
And you've been involved in quite a number of startups.
Yeah.
Could you just tell us about the first startup that you worked for and what do you think attributed the success that you achieved?
I probably in my career, and I've been in business now for more than 40 years, probably done around 20 different startups around the world, and there's been big ones and small ones and medium-sized ones. Mm-hmm. But the one that I will refer to was probably one of the most successful ones early on in my career, and this was when I joined Unilever. I was working for one of Unilever's prestige companies, and it was in the cosmetic industry, and it was a company called Elizabeth Arden. Does any of you know Elizabeth Arden?
Yes.
And Calvin Klein?
Yes.
Now Arden and Klein were a global business, and they operated with country organizations around the world. So like an example, in Europe they had an operation in every country, so 12 operations in Europe. And they had operations in Southeast Asia, in Australasia, and so on and so forth. So I got the idea, actually in a pub in the UK over a beer, that I draw a vision on a napkin, how I could consolidate all of that into a single operating unit. And I did that, and we set up a new business in Geneva, Switzerland, where we basically consolidated all activities from around the world into this single entity. And that included the worldwide duty-free, so all the duty-free airports and ships and so on and so forth, both in Europe, Middle East, Africa, Asia, and the Americas. And that was very, very successful. And even during that process, we worked with Citibank, an example. And I was working with Citibank to create the first global cash management system that supported this particular business. The reason for the success, well, it's all about people. It's about picking the right team to be engaged in the process of doing that conversion. Also, make sure you've got a well-structured strategy, you've got a good business case, and you have buy-in from the chairman of Unilever and the various chairmen around the world to do this. The only flip side of that, because I was then made, you know, you developed a strategy, you implemented, and then you also made responsible for running the business out of Geneva. There was a few flip sides to that. First of all, I had to go to fashion shows in Paris every 3-4 months. I was on the selection committee of new models for Arden. And so it was a very mixed, a very good school to go in. But the key success factor in all of that, as I said, is about people, picking the right people. Yeah.
Okay, so you've done fashion, you've done telecoms.
I've done cosmetics, and I've done, I've done many different things. I've done foods, ice cream, and color cosmetics. I built a color cosmetics factory in China, where I was based for 18 months. And we built a factory just outside Shanghai. And it became ISO standard, all of it, in 14 months, and a great success.
So when Vodafone was formed in Zambia, you came in at a time when we were going through some economic hardships.
Yeah.
And from many entrepreneurs, I mean, you hear how they'll say, this is really a bad time, this is hard, it's really hard to set up a business in Zambia. But you still decided to come, even with the existing ISPs. Could you just shed some more light with regards to how you saw an opportunity?
Yeah, I think when you look at globally, when you look at internet or connectivity, but also what people are actually using data for, like you have the WhatsApp, you've got Facebook, you've got all this social media activity, there's a significant growth rates in this part of the world. Because again, you have a significant amount of youth. So if you look at the growing trends in the digital space with Facebook and the rest of it, Africa is growing faster than Europe. It's growing faster than the States. So therefore, and one of the reasons, the internet penetration in most African countries are very, very low. I think when we joined, internet penetration in Zambia was in average around 16%. Yeah. But there was a huge demand for data, and the communication sector in Zambia is undergoing significant transition. So turning into what primarily will be a significant growth in data services. So moving away from the traditional voice into data services. And how many of you have a smartphone?
Don't be shy.
But smartphones today is not just for making the call, it's actually for surfing on the internet, looking at Facebook, calling, you know, using WhatsApp. So the smartphone is much more relevant for data services than for voice. Now, so you will find going forward, and that's why when we set up the business, we said that our vision is becoming the next generation 4G LTE data services company in Zambia. And it's all about the new world. We're not going to operate in the antiquated space like MTN and Airtel, because we don't have a huge traditional voice business to support. So we can focus on digital services, data services, which is the fastest growing component of the telecommunications industry. So we are Vodafone Zambia. We are in a way transforming the way Zambians communicate. And so far we have invested probably around $40 million on that journey. And much more investment will come into the country in this year and the years to come. But the key opportunity we saw, or I saw even before coming in here, was the youth segment, but also the SME segment. Because I firmly believe that both these segments, and not only in Zambia, in many of the sub-Saharan countries, are being underserved with good quality connectivity. And for me, it's not just the quality connectivity, it's actually what you can use that connectivity for. And I'll talk a little bit about that later.
Okay, so even with the existing competition that was already here in Zambia, and I'd like to believe you've already broken even, what did you do differently? Because you seem to be a preferred brand.
Well, first of all, we must not underestimate the value of the brand. Now, the Vodafone brand, which is a global brand, the Vodafone is in the top five operators on a global basis. Vodafone got more than 450 million subscribers around the world. But they got a very recognizable brand. And actually, when we moved into Zambia, the brand awareness of the Vodafone brand was significant. I think it was around 60%. And the main reason for that is that most African countries are into football or soccer. And Manchester United, which is a very famous global property, was sponsored by Vodafone some years ago. And that's what built the brand awareness. So that's one reason, yeah? Can you repeat the question?
I'm saying, what have you done differently, considering you came at a time when we had existing companies that were offering similar services,
yeah,
and you seem to be quite successful?
Well, sorry, yeah, one thing is the brand, clearly. Mm-hmm. But the second thing, if you look at our strategy, mm-hmm, number one, two, and three priority, mm-hmm, is quality of service. And if there's something the Zambian people are not used to, it's quality of service. Yeah? And so quality was a key pillar in our strategy and a key pillar in our success. I think we also then, we wanted to be a young organization, building products and services for young people, like the youth segment, as I referred to a couple of times. So we hired a lot of young people. So they are fresh out from universities. And one of the reasons for that, when you do a startup with a vision and a strategy, it's very, very critical that you hire people based on capability and not just based on experience. And it's anything that young people have capability for is to know how to manage technology. I got two grandchildren. My 12-year-old grandson, he's smarter on a laptop and games and on the phone than I am. So the young people understand that side of it. And that paid off big time, because I think we've been able to develop products and services that have met the hearts and the minds of the youth segment in the country.
You have initiated a platform called The Jam, which provides free resources to our entrepreneurs. I think education, self-development, Could you just share, just care to explain what the Jump program is all about?
Well, when we, again, when you, if you focus on the youth segment, we were looking at what opportunity existed to provide the youth with a tool that could enable them to better themselves, empower them, if you will, with different things. Now, one of them, and as I said before, we hired a lot of young people into the organization. We got a graduate program, probably second to none in Zambia. I believe that we will be the single corporate that have the highest intake of graduates, even though we're only 120 people. Yeah? We also have brand ambassadors. We've got around 300 brand ambassadors from the major 10 learning institutions, so including UNSA and CBU, NIPA, or whatever they're called around the country. So we had to find a way to link all this together, but also to capture what is in the mind of the student. And you will find that globally, what's in the mind of the student is very similar. What are they, what's their thoughts? What are they thinking on? And it's four things. It's education is one. It's entrepreneurship, self-improvement. It's lifestyle, it's entertainment. So that's in all young people's or students' minds, social media and stuff like that. The difference between Africa and, if you take the US, is that the student in Africa is much more focused on education and get the opportunity to tap in to educational program. So Jump was in a way to capture all of that in a single platform. And it covers today education, lifestyle and entertainment, entrepreneurship and self-improvement. And the educational side is actually transforming the way people educate themselves. If you look at countries like Zambia or Cameroon or Ghana, the quality of the educational system in terms of availability of schools, availability of technology, is pretty poor. If you could come out with a platform where we actually transfer the education out of the traditional classroom or as an add-on to the additional education and enable people to do it online, that's what we want to achieve. And that is the tremendous focus on the Jump platform. We are just about launching what we call the Jump Academy. And that's basically lectures by, or video programs by local professors or lecturers in Zambia. And that will be launched by end of January, I think, or end of February. We're also launching a music section to the platform. But it's not like iTunes. It's not where you can buy, what are they called, Lady Gaga or this young man, Justin Timberlake or whatever they're called. But it's where we go out and identify musical talent in Zambia. So we will liaise with universities or where talent is available, and we will provide them the opportunity to upload a music video on the site. There will be competition amongst the best artists, and they could actually win an opportunity of becoming part of a Deezer platform. Do you know what Deezer is? It's basically a musical platform where you can stream music. Yeah. We've done a similar program. We hosted the Fashion Week in Zambia last year, which was very, very successful. So we're going to provide a tool that young people can use to help them in education, in entrepreneurship, in self-improvement, but also lifestyle and entertainment. Yeah. And we actually launched it now in Zambia, and we launched it in Cameroon. We're launching it in Uganda on the 10th of February, and in Ghana on the 15th of February. We already have more than 250,000 followers. And my expectation over the next 18 months to 2 years, that we will have 5 million followers across Africa on the platform. And that's when it becomes powerful. That's where you can best invest in educational programs that touch every young person in the African community. And I can only encourage that everybody that's here tonight, have a look at it. Have a look at Jump and follow the development over the next 2 to 3 months. And you will find, it might not be the Facebook of Africa, but it will be a tool where local content from the youth segment will be consolidated and made available to all youth around the African continent. So it's a platform for African youth produced by African youth.
Coming back to the entrepreneurship aspect with your experience and having lived in all these different countries and being a mobile service provider, what opportunities do you have for entrepreneurs?
Well, entrepreneurs, well, we're doing something ourselves. On the Jump platform, we will have an entrepreneurial or entrepreneur competition of young entrepreneurs. And we will promote and support the best entrepreneurs coming out of the universities we work with today. Yeah?
Okay. And from a service aspect, do you also give business to Zambian entrepreneurs for some services that
operate? No, absolutely. I think, absolutely. No, I'm very, I take a great pride of working with Zambians in the way we set up the business. And that in every area of the business, as I said, it's young graduates from universities, but even our suppliers, our media agency. Normally when you come from a big organization like Vodafone, you select the biggest media agencies from around the world, either from London or from Johannesburg or Nairobi. We actually picked an agency of young 25-year-old kids from Zambia. And they've been developing our TV campaign. They're developing all our creative material. They started with us in Zambia in June last year, when we launched. They are now our media agency in Cameroon, in Uganda, in Ghana. They will be in Burundi and they will be in Ivory Coast.
The same
agency.
So you're taking them out.
We're taking them out and we're exporting that out of the country. And for me that's great. You know, that it's a wonderful experience. But the TVC campaign, most of you I hope have seen it. But not only have it been regionally renowned, one of the best TV campaigns, also Vodafone globally have used that in some of their, or a similar structure in some of their other operations. And that again cements the fact that if you are able to take the best and the brightest, offer the students the opportunity, Zambia could become something else. And I know I've been in the press recently said that Zambia could become the Silicon Valley of South Africa. If you put your mind and you have the vision, it's doable. Because one of the, we had a lot of success with the program, as we talked about earlier. But it has to be private enterprise that demonstrates you can do it. And if you have a winning formula, it's much easier to go and talk to the government and say we need support. So I was meeting the Minister of Communication earlier this week, and he now wants to work with me to set up innovation centers and creative centers for technology in Zambia. And we're actually building the first one under the name Jump that will be launched in April of this year. And it will basically be a ICT innovation center where young people can go and play with the technology, develop applications or other stuff, yeah? But the government are now interested in working with Vodafone because what we demonstrated to our youth program and also the SME program that we're going to launch in 3 months' time in the country. Yeah?
I'm actually excited to hear you say that you've seen Zambia as the Silicon Valley of the Southern Africa. I'm sure you're all excited to hear that. It's very encouraging. I'd like to hear from you, what are some of the challenging moments you've experienced as a leader in this startup?
In the startup?
Yes.
This startup.
Any startup, your most challenging moment?
I think that one of the reasons that we've been very successful in Zambia, and also now Cameroon and Uganda, and I'm sure we will be in Ghana as well, you need to have a very clear vision. And you need to have a well-documented strategy. And if you go through that and you develop that, and you pick a very good team, because at the end of the day, it's all about people. It's people that develops and do the creativity, the innovation, to put it together so it meets the hearts and the minds of the consumer. Yeah? So the vision, the strategy, and a strong team to implement is, for me, the key critical success factors.
Yeah. And your most challenging moment?
It's a lovely environment. And we are trying to build a culture that's very similar to the Google culture around the world. So where everybody do whatever it takes to deliver the high quality experience to our customer. Yeah? So yeah, you have a job description, but you really do. You work in all areas to make sure we achieve our targets and objectives. If you go to the antiquated world, which is the existing operators, they don't understand that. And if you're not careful, that can slow you down. So that was frustrating. But my position now, I would rather go out and get more graduates. Because they know, and they have the capability. They might not have the experience, but they certainly have the capability to deliver what it is we need to deliver. And we got some lovely success stories of some of the young graduates we've taken into the business. We got a young guy in IT, and he came from UNSA 10, 12 months ago. He could be an IT director in a year's time. We took a young girl into marketing, and she's already run campaigns. She's running a major campaign for us right now that will be launched in a couple of weeks' time. But she already have been to Uganda to help Uganda launch the same strategy as we launched in. So it's amazing what you can do if you provide the wherewithal, the tools, and the mentorship to these young people.
I like that you're really interested in investing in the young, in the youth of today. I'd like to hear from you, Lars. What inspires you? What motivates you?
Well, my wife is here, I think so. Anyway.
Yes, she is.
I am passionate about youth. And what Duke gives me a kick when I see the success story, like with the young IT guy, when I see what young people can actually do. And remember, we've only been in the country, we launched in June of last year. We probably already impacted more than 1,500 young people's lives. And that, I'm proud about, yeah? And I want to do more. I'm a very impatient man, I want to move very fast. But that does inspire me. And I think again in a startup like this, many people, you know, you lead with your mind, but you also have to lead with your heart. Yeah? And if your heart is in it, the opportunity for success is so much greater. Yeah?
So what's a typical day like for us?
Oh, it's, you know, I get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, I do my emails, I have my coffee, I go to the office now. 7:30, and then it's meetings and interaction with the youngsters. It's talking to Cameroon. I'm not only the CEO of Zambia, by the way, I'm also the Chief Operating Officer for Africa. So I'm responsible for Cameroon and Ghana and Uganda. So we spend a lot of time on the phone with them. I interact with my marketing team. I'm very into creativity, innovation, and stuff like that. But it's basically meetings and try to mentor people as well. Because, as I told you earlier, I've been retired four times. I really don't have a lot of career aspiration. But if I can make other people successful, then I've done my job. And not only the youngster, but my leadership team as well. If I can mentor them to deliver in a country like this and learn from me, they're better equipped to become the next CEO in another operation and hopefully transfer some of the philosophy that I have in terms of how we run businesses in Africa.
So what are your thoughts about the Zambian startup scene for startups?
Well, I think there's a great opportunity for startups in Zambia, I think. You know, for SMEs or for young people, if they get the proper education and so on and so forth, I think it's everybody's playing field. But as I said before, I think you need support. You need to continue to better yourself, education. If you want to launch a business, you need to make sure that the vision, the strategy, and you know what you're doing, and you get the support from people who've been there before. And that's why it's so important to me or to us that on the job platform we allow people that opportunity where we can guide them, help them. How do I develop a business plan? How do I develop a strategy? How do I take it to market? Right now I'm working with some graduates from SICAS and a couple from UNSA who want to set up an e-commerce business in Zambia. So they're kind of doing research, they're working on the business plan, but I'm mentoring and guiding them in the right direction based on my own experience. And I'm so happy to do that because that demonstrates that you can do it if you have the right mind, the right heart, and the tools and the support, everything is possible.
Can we get the mics ready? We'll take questions from the audience. If you have a question, you can just raise your hand. And I hope the Vodafone team has managed to get a table and they're setting up. For the information that he shared, you could get more information from that table. So if you have a question, please just raise your hand. Someone will bring the mic to you. Oh, the table is set? Oh, awesome.
To work with everybody or anybody that supports the same ideals and have the same vision about what you can do when you support the youth environment and the segment. Yeah? So if you have the same sort of objectives and passion, you should book an appointment and come and see me. Yeah? Okay.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, Paul. My biggest question is, in Zambia we have a common problem that we call status quo. And people are content with who they are and what they are, but lack goals and vision. In relation to your career, where you come from, and in relation to Africa, What's the biggest way what's the biggest, I'm going to say, stepping stone that you've had to deal with in relation to status quo? We're trying to encourage employees as well as the youth to become proactive, as opposed to sitting back and waiting for them to be told what to do.
Yeah, I think it's again that can be an issue, and what I alluded to earlier was when the old world meets the new world, yeah? And even when we were staffing up, I talked about getting level 3 from the antiquated world. It's very difficult, yeah? Because they actually like and appreciate status quo. Now, in countries in Africa, it is a problem. But the only way you deal with the problem is actually demonstrate to people that it can be done. You can change and you can impact your own future. Now, in career aspirations are different things. One of the problems, I saw that in Nigeria, there's some of it in Zambia, people aspire to become something for the wrong reasons, yeah? If you come in as a young person in an organization, you aspire to become a supervisor, then you aspire to become a manager, and you aspire to become a director. But the reasons you want to be a director is not because you want to mentor people and all that good stuff and lead an organization. You then believe that you can sit in an ivory tower and just get people to do the work for you. Yeah? That doesn't work in the new world. Even at my level, I'm hands-on. And you need to participate, you need to interact with young people. We have a brilliant story on the jump platform. And we are trying to use the platform also to showcase examples of young people that made it happen. Yeah? So an example, we got a young girl called Sela from Cha-Cha-Cha, which is a rural area in the Copper Belt. And she's 18, 19 years old. She went to a normal school where she lived. But she had this mind, she wanted to become a space engineer or spacecraft engineer. But she was so determined, with such a strong mindset, that late last year she was accepted into the Harvard University in the States, studying what she wanted to do. And the more we can portray these kind of story, the more we can illustrate that it is possible. If you put your mind to it and you have the support, both from companies like Vodafone, from the government, or the Zambian Development Agency, or whatever they're called, it's possible, yeah? But it does take a lot. It doesn't happen by itself, yeah?
You've mentioned a number of things, and my concern is what's the strategy? Because we have seen a lot of companies which are providing ISP services in the country are just measuring on local towns, Lusaka being one of the most pointed to, and Copper Belt and all such, the new LTE, 4G, Zambia did the same thing, went to Copper Belt. But then we still get to leave out the people in the rural areas. So we are wondering to say, how does Vodafone look at such kind of situations? What's our strategy to reach out to the rural areas? Because we believe they also need such kind of education. I hate to speak about it, but I just want to hear the study. Then the second thing is, apart from innovation centers, I believe it takes more to have a Silicon Valley in Zambia, because they've tried in other countries and has not been that successful. So I was trying to find out from you to say how much more, most especially when we look at the bundles, data bundles, and all such kind of things, the access to the internet, how easier can Vodafone make it for SMEs? Thank you.
Your first question, where you talk about there's a lot of ISPs in the country, and there's one problem that we need to factor in is the quality of service. And I experienced that myself when I travel around. You know, it's like the signal on your car. It works, it doesn't, it works, it doesn't. Or I try to have a Skype call or interview people over Skype, and it breaks down in the middle of the call. So the quality of service, quite honestly, has been appalling. Number two is when you start up the business, because nobody, I'm not a philanthropist, it's a win-win, so there's a commercial aspect in it as well. Now, if you take Zambia as a country, the two major regions is Lusaka and the Copperbelt. Yeah? And you have to be there. That's where the corporate, the youngsters, and so on and so forth. There are urbanization in Zambia. Now, then we will take it from there. But what we are going to do, what we are going to do, and starting this year, is to roll out connectivity to all community centers in the 130 districts. And we're going to pilot one in Lusaka, working with the daughter of the president, to really try and make an impact in an area where people are underserved and underprivileged because they can't afford to go to higher learning institutions. So they will be able to access the job platform, they will be able to get the education and so on and so on. Now that probably what will be Vodafone's contribution, but as I said earlier, setting up an innovation center in Lusaka will be first. There will be more like that around the country. But this is where the government needs to chip in. So the ICT strategy, I firmly believe, and I might write to the president myself, and say we need to set up a separate leg within the ICT organization that focuses on this. Yeah? How we get fast-speed internet, how we can benefit from all these new tools, both in education, and in entrepreneurship, in development of new products and services. So I think we sowed the seed, and we'll do more, but others will join to make that happen. Yeah?
I know you're already launching, and it's always the case with most businesses when you're launching, you start off in your most mature market and then phase it out and bring it where you need to be. Zambia is, I would say, quite mature, very hungry for data, very hungry for business. I would urge you to take the risk in Zambia first before you run to Uganda to do the business there. Before you run to the other market first, do the reverse. Yes, it's worked previously and you've got people well established and you've got the right people, like you said. But I would say take the risk in Zambia because the appetite is definitely there. We're crazy about new things. You know, we'll lose our money first before we even care about the fact that it was good or not. You know, so I would urge you to start with Zambia whenever you're trying to market a new product. Use Zambia as a test market because the appetite is there, the energy is there, and the population is there. You've already identified the fact that, yes, the younger crowd, yes, Uganda, Zimbabwe, and all sorts of things are more educated in the sense that the education structure is well established in those countries compared to Zambia. But I think in terms of per capita, in terms of money spent, you would actually get more in Zambia to achieve what you need to do. So we ask, as a Zambia, start the projects here first, please. And then, roll them out to our friends and our neighbors and everything else like that. And then we'll be able to tell you, as SMEs, how far you've made us. Because I know, for example, you know, you just coming on the market, I don't need to use your competitor A, I won't say their name, but you can eradicate from that. And your competitor, you know, M, you know, who is out there, and politely not actually mentioning the name, but I've significantly saved so much money, and I've significantly benefited from the fact that I can do business faster, I can do business anywhere, I can do business more mobily, and I'm grateful for that you actually brought that to the market, and please roll that to the second level, and we'll appreciate it even further.
Now that was, I don't know whether that was more of an advice than that it was a question. Let me just pick up on 2 points though. I think the first one is, and I'm not sure I mentioned that, but given the success we had in Zambia, the African headquarter, and I don't really like the word headquarter, but the rest of Africa is managed out of Zambia. So all products and services will be developed in Zambia first, and then rolled out after we tested it in Zambia. So Zambia have the benefit. Was that the guy who asked the question?
Zambia have the benefit. Huh? And your marketing guy.
And my marketing guy.
Michael,
yeah. Well, I will come back to that later, but so we're actually doing what you're saying. We are developing in Zambia. Even the creative agency is Zambian. So everything you'll find in Cameroon or Uganda or Ghana or Ivory Coast will be developed here. Now, when you think about that and the opportunity that create for jobs for young people in Zambia, not only to build product and services for Zambia, but also build something that we can export outside the country. So you agree with me on that, right? The second point, and this is more my advice to you, never ever hire young people because they're cheaper than older people. No, I'm not joking. Because that is what people tend to do. They hire cheap labor. If you hire students, don't hire them because they're cheap labor, but hire them as an investment into your business. Mentor, educate, and develop them to become the future leaders of the country. That's what you have to do. That's the responsibility you have to take on board. Not to expose them and use them because they're cheap, okay?
Brilliant, people, let me support.
So apart from loans and microfinance, are you strategically thinking around, you know, investing some of the ideas? Because yes, it's great to give people internet and space, but there's still that last mile, if I can put it that in Zambia, where you still need to be able to invest, yes, in bankable startups. Second question is around API. So we do find that for most tech startups, it's very difficult to integrate with tech companies or tech platforms. So is there any plan as to opening APIs for tech businesses that want to integrate with Vodafone platforms?
Yeah, well, on the first question, we are not investing in startups. Now, you have to remember, we are a startup ourselves, and it's Afrimax Vodafone. So we are a partnership market with Vodafone. But we are in the same boat, so we need to get funding for all the things we are doing. So we are not in the mode where we actually invest in other startup businesses. My hope, though, is as we further develop the job platform, we start to get sponsors on the job platform, we might be able to invest in development of entrepreneurs, but not as investors, but as donors, if you will, to young and bright entrepreneurs. Now, in terms of interface API, I think the technology center and creative center we are developing would provide an avenue where you can have a look at that. Yeah? Come and visit us at Vodafone, connect with Vodafone, help us drive the youth agenda. If you're SMEs, come and talk to you about your business and how we can help you. Not only get connected, but how you can benefit from the connectivity. Thank you.